DaVinci Resolve 20 is out of beta and has been officially released. Now is the time to upgrade. Here is a roundup of our 10 favorite features. As always, we're saving the best until last. Number 10, stylized subtitles. We're starting with something fun. There is an increasing number of legitimate cases for stylizing subtitles. For example, social media videos. There's a collection of subtitle templates that you can choose from. Templates are found in the Effects panel. Drag the subtitle preset you'd like to use on the subtitle track header. And now that effect will get applied to every single subtitle. What's even cooler is that this feature will work with any Fusion title template, so you can have epic subtitles like this. There's a special category of animated subtitles. When applied to the subtitle track, these will highlight each word as it's said. Just like before, drag the preset onto the subtitle track header and voila! If you've generated your subtitles with automatic subtitling, the timing will be super accurate. If you've manually created your subtitles, it's gonna have to guess the timing. This video is sponsored by Audio. Get an entire year of music and sound effects for just $60. 9. Voice cloning. This feature is pretty wild. It's now possible to convert someone's voice without leaving DaVinci Resolve. This tool uses AI to profile people's voices and then convert a recording to sound like that person. Voice profiles are generated in the media pool. Here's a recording of Leon from one of our previous videos. The quality of the voice profile will depend on the quality of the recording you're learning from. Ideally, a high-quality recording in a treated room works best. We'd recommend around 10 minutes of speech. Right-click, go to AI Tools and DaVinci AI Voice Training. Choose a name for your new preset. I'm not in a rush, so I'll choose better quality. Let's go! The training happens in the background, so you can continue to use Resolve. It's worth noting, this profiling process happens on device. It is not being sent out to a cloud server. Now you've made your voice profile, find the clip you want to convert in your timeline. Right-click on the audio and go to Voice Convert. There's that Leon voice profile I created. Hit Convert and Resolve will apply the conversion. There are some really interesting use cases for this tool. It doesn't necessarily need to be used to change someone's voice. Instead, if you have bad audio on a recording, you can use a profile of the very person who's in the scene to clean up their own recording. Please note, this tool does not convert people's accents. It works best when the target and voice model are similar in their speech patterns. It's still incredibly powerful. Have a go and tell us what you think. Number 8, Multicam Smart Switch. From one amazing tool to another, Multicam Smart Switch will produce automatic edits of multicam sequences. It's going to be particularly useful for editing podcasts and interviews. Leon and I shot a very quick demonstration. It's a multicam with three angles. Right-click on the multicam clip, go to Multicam Smart Switch. I'll make some changes to the default settings. Increasing the minimum edit duration will make the edit a little calmer. It can automatically detect wide angles, or you can manually tell it which angle is the wide. This option is really helpful. You can influence how often it cuts to the wide. Finally, as this tool has to analyze the multicam clip to work out who is speaking, it can't simply rely on audio for that because your interview might not have separate audio tracks, or audio might bleed from one microphone to the other. So it uses visual recognition to work out who is speaking. Once everything is configured, hit Analyze. That's amazing. It's cut back and forth based on who is speaking, and it's followed the instructions I gave it regarding the wides. This feature is going to save hours of work for people producing podcasts and interviews. Number 7, View Color Grade in Media Out. In Resolve's order of operations, Fusion comes before color. That means when you are on the Fusion page, you will not see your color grade in the viewer. Now you can view your color grade on the Fusion page. Select the Media Out node. There's a new option called Color Grade. Select color and the Fusion viewer will show you your color page adjustments. Awesome, but wait, it gets even better. This third option, Mix, allows you to see the color page adjustments plus any compositing work done back on the edit or color page. So happy to see this implemented. Number 6, quality of life. Before we get into the final 5, our next mention goes to all the tiny features that have a big impact on your quality of life. We really appreciate it when Blackmagic revisits older features, the ones we're already using, to make improvements. Here's some of our favorites. Resolve could read PSD files, but layers were only accessible on the Fusion page. PSD layers are now accessible on the Edit page. Right-click on a PSD clip in your timeline and go to Split PSD Layers in Place. Those layers are now spread across multiple tracks. You can edit and manipulate them as you wish. It was possible to record voiceover in Resolve on the Fairlight page, but it required patching and arming of tracks. There are now easy-to-use voiceover recording controls. In the Edit page, it's accessible by going to the Timeline menu and selecting Record Voiceover. Or you can click on this button here. Choose a name for the clip, select your audio source, and decide which track you'd like the audio to be recorded onto. There's additional options in the triple dot menu. On the cut page, click here to open the voiceover controls, or click here to configure them. Moving on, compound clips are awesome, as is the ability to open them within a timeline by right-clicking and going to Open in Timeline. When moving into a compound clip, it now respects the location of the playhead. As you can see, the frame displayed in the timeline viewer did not change. When creating complex graphics, you might have layers and layers of text plus clips on the timeline. Your timeline can now be simplified with the multi-text tool. Instead of creating multiple text plus clips, you can now create a single multi-text clip and using its controls, create multiple text elements within. Smooth Cut is a fantastic tool for patching jump cuts. There's a new option called AI Speed Warp. It's enabled by default and it produces a dramatically better result. Finally, Render Cache. Has the Render Cache ever eaten up all your free hard drive space? Resolve can now automatically clear old files from your cache. This setting can be configured in user preferences. We've barely scratched the surface of those quality of life improvements. Individually, they are small, but when added together, they have had a significant impact on our work.
Before we continue, can we show you where we find music for our videos? Most library music websites feature filters that allow you to search by mood, genre, and instrumentation. Even then, it can still be hard finding the right music for your edit. Audio has two incredible AI assistants that can help. First, Hans AI. Simply describe your video or describe the type of music you're looking for, and Hans will suggest six tracks that might fit. Second, Link Match AI. It's common to take inspiration from commercial music. If you've heard a song you like, provide Link Match with a link so it can listen. It will search Audio's own royalty-free library and suggest similar tracks that you can actually use. We love it when AI is used to enhance your creativity rather than replace it. Audio has a ton of other features you'll love, but we think your favorite feature will be the incredible price. Using our discount code, you can get an entire year of Audio for just $60. A big thank you to Audio for supporting our videos.
Number 5, Music Retimer and Beat Detection. We're clumping these two similar features together. The ability to edit music by simply changing its length has been on a lot of people's wish lists for a long time. Wait no longer, it is here and it is awesome. AI Music Editor is found by selecting the clip and going to the inspector. Simply type in your desired length and Resolve will analyze the song and retime it. It's not changing its speed, it's cutting sections out or looping them depending on whether you're shortening or lengthening the song. The result is a remix of the original song that preserves its tempo and pace. While being able to type in numbers is precise, most people would probably prefer to use live trim. Once this checkbox is enabled, you can adjust the song's length using the normal trim tools in the timeline. Each time you change the length of the track, it automatically re-edits the music. These lines in the clip show where edits have been made. As you can see, this tool has preserved the intro of the song and the outro as well. It's not fading out, the song has a proper ending. In the inspector, you'll notice that you can choose between different versions of the edit. It will provide up to 4 different versions. Finally, if you want to use this as a starting point for further editing the music yourself, right-click on the clip, go to Decompose in Place. Now those edit points are editable. Next, Beat Detection. This is a separate feature, but is closely related. That's why we've lumped them together. Right-click on the clip and go to Show Music Beats. Once analyzed, Resolve displays beat markers on the clip. Now the music beats have been detected, edit operations will snap to those beats. This is helpful for remixing a song yourself or for matching your edit to the music. Number 4, Magic Mask and Depth Map. Yes, we're being cheeky and we're clumping another two features together. It's the only way we can get all our favorite stuff in a simple top 10. These are not new features, but they have been greatly improved. We're gonna start with Depth Map. From looking at the controls, you might not realize this has been overhauled, but it has. It's all underneath the bonnet. It works exactly the same as before, but produces a more detailed depth map. To highlight the improvements, we ran the same clips through version 19's depth map and version 20's depth map. As you can see, there's a significant improvement in quality. While depth map is still called depth map, you'll notice that Magic Mask is now called Magic Mask version 2. That's because not only has the underlying engine been overhauled, but the way objects are selected has also changed. The interface looks similar, but it no longer has separate tabs for tracking objects and people. In the previous version of Magic Mask, objects were chosen by drawing strokes. In version 2, a simple click is all that's needed. Like before, additional clicks can be used to include additional objects in your mask. And subtractive clicks can be used to exclude objects that you do not wish to be included in your mask. The subtractive picker can be temporarily enabled by holding down on Option or Alt, or by selecting the subtractive picker tool here. If there are issues with the Magic Mask, they can be addressed using the new inbuilt paint tools. Unlike the picker used to build the Magic Mask, these do not have any effect on the generation of the Magic Mask, and they cannot be tracked into the image. Each paint stroke lasts only one frame. This tool is useful for cleaning up minor issues with the mask. Both Magic Mask version 2 and Depth Map are useful for creating secondary grades that affect portions of your image. These tools are moving in the direction where, in some instances, they are approaching pixel-perfect results. Tool number 3, IntelliScript. We're into the final 3. This one's going to have a huge impact on our workflows, especially when creating videos like this. Transcription changed the way we edit dialogue. IntelliScript is about to completely change it again. Find your clips in the media pool, right-click, and go to AI Tools. Create new timeline using IntelliScript. The script doesn't have to be in a fancy format. This is just a text file. Select it and click Open. And there you go. Wherever there are additional takes of the same line, Resolve will stack them in the tracks above, disabled by default. To produce a rough assembly like this myself would have taken hours of work. Using Resolve's brand new IntelliScript tool, it's taken me mere seconds. It's absolutely amazing. Now I can go through refining edits and selecting takes. Number 2. As is often the case, our favorite features are the ones we use all the time. Previously, it was possible to have more than one timeline open in Resolve. That's what stacked timelines are for. It was also possible to load timelines as a source clip into the source viewer. Resolve version 20 now takes that one step further. You can now edit timelines from the source viewer. Drag the timeline to the source viewer, or if you right-click on a timeline and go to Open Timeline with Source Viewer, not only is it loaded into the source viewer, but the timeline itself is opened below. It's possible to have both the source and primary timelines open using stacked timelines. Why is this significant? A lot of feature, episodic, and documentary editors, especially those who work in Avid, use timelines to create string outs and then edit those clips into their primary timeline. The absence of this feature in Resolve was a sticking point for a lot of people. It's now easier to use those workflows in Resolve. This is our favorite feature. It's not flashy AI, it's not even really added new functionality. It's the revamp of the edit page keyframing interface. Many people have struggled with Resolve's edit page keyframe editor. The UI was nested within the clip on the timeline, making it difficult to see and use. The edit page now features not one, but two entire panels dedicated to keyframing. The primary panel for keyframing is accessed with this button. It displays keyframes for the currently selected clip. It's possible to control which properties are shown. This option to show only keyframed properties is particularly useful. This dialog will also show keyframable properties of any additional effects you add to the clip. For example, if I add lens blur to this clip and drop a keyframe, you can see that property is now visible. We're currently looking at the parameter view. There's another, curve view. It gives you a super cool graph that shows how those properties change over time. Now that you're in this mode, you can change the timings of animations by moving the keyframes left and right, but you can also change those keyframe values by moving them up and down. Like before, you can change the keyframe interpolation by selecting the keyframe and hitting one of these buttons up here. By far, the thing about this awesome new feature that makes us the happiest is that the shift modifier key can finally be used to constrain movements to either the X or Y axis. Blackmagic have given us a second interface for viewing keyframes. The keyframe tray can be enabled with this button, but as it's directly beneath the timeline and synced with the timeline zoom level, it provides a really intuitive way of timing your keyframes with your edit. Well, that's it. Those were our favorite features based on the work that we do. But everyone's work is different, so we'd love to know what yours are. Post a comment below and let us know your top three favorite features. We might not have even mentioned your favorite feature. That's because Blackmagic has added so much to DaVinci Resolve 20, we couldn't possibly include everything in a single video. For a more thorough overview of what got added in version 20, go watch our 4 beta videos. Although the features might have changed slightly, it's still a really good overview of the new tools. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a like, consider sharing it with someone, and please make sure you're subscribed so you can get notified for future Resolve videos. Now go make something awesome, and thanks so much for watching.